Hi, I'm Effie and this is What Effie Reads. Today's video is going to be my May wrap-up. During the month of May, I participated in BookNetathon, which was a month-long readathon organised by Bookish KJ. The way it worked is you got a bingo board with 14 different bookish creators on it, plus a square for a smaller booktuber and a free space. And over the course of the month, you needed to read books inspired by each of those creators to fill up your bingo board. As this is a wrap-up video and I will be discussing a lot of different books, feel free to jump around. I will pop the timestamps in the description down below. It's been pointed out to me that I don't give ratings during my book, during my videos for the books that I've read. So quickly, I'll just say I rate books out of 20 and then scale them down when I'm popping them on Storygraph so that they're out of 5. During this video, I will give all my ratings out of 20. If I give a book a low rating, that's not necessarily me saying that the book was bad, just that I didn't enjoy it. And if I were to go back on my Storygraph later, I would know that I didn't enjoy it, if that makes sense. There's at least one book that I read during the course of May that I scored quite low, but that's because it wasn't a book for me, not that it was a bad book. The first books that I'm going to talk about are the books that I read for BookNetathon. I'm going to go through these in the order that I read them. And the first of them was Speak by Laurie Halse Anderson, and this is the graphic novel with artwork by Emily Carroll. This was a book that I probably wouldn't have picked up if I had known what it was about, especially given that it is a graphic novel. However, I'm really, really glad that I did pick it up, and I thought that the way that it dealt with the very, very difficult subject matter was absolutely beautiful. And I really don't know what to say. I just absolutely adored it. It was a 17 out of 20 for me. So for this book, I ticked off the square for Paperback Dreams. The next book I've got is When Life Gives You Mangoes by Kareen Gettan. This was a really, really beautiful book. It was one that I thought was going in a particular direction, and then suddenly it hit you with the twist, and I was absolutely blown away. It's an absolutely beautiful book. And it was a 16 out of 20 for me. This book I used for the Petite Punk Square for BookNetathon. The next book that we've got is Heartstopper by Alice Oseman, and this is volume 1. This is a book that, for whatever reason, I've been putting off. I think I thought that it wouldn't be for me. And now that I've read it, I have gone and bought the next 3 volumes because I loved it so, so much. And in fact, the only notes that I've got on it in front of me just say, so darn sweet. And it really, really is. I'm hoping that in the month of May, I can read all 4 back to back. This book was a 17 out of 20 for me. And I used it for the Monica Kim Square of BookNetathon. The next book we've got is Everything Together by Benjamin Class. I am not going to put an image of this book cover on the screen, as the cover itself gives spoilers for the first book. So Everything Together is the sequel to Second Dad Summer, which follows Jeremiah as he spends the summer with his father and his father's new boyfriend. The events of Everything Together quite nicely follow on from everything that happened in Second Dad Summer. But again, it deals with some important issues in a way that is sensitive and engaging. It was a sequel that I didn't know that I wanted, and now that I have, I just want more from this series. And it was an 18 out of 20, and I used this for the How to Train Your Gavin square. The next book that I've got is Chain of Iron by Cassandra Clare. This is the second book in the Last Hours series, and it follows the children of the characters that you first meet in the Infernal Devices, who were also the ancestors of the characters that you meet in the Mortal Instruments series. This book was one of my most anticipated releases for 2021. I really quite enjoyed Chain of Gold, so I was very much looking forward to seeing what these characters got up to. And I would say that overall it was okay. I enjoyed it well enough as I was reading it. However, the ending just wasn't very strong. There felt like there was a distinct lack of stakes and no sense of peril at the end. Although I did really, really enjoy the additional content right at the end, which featured Magnus and Jem having a little adventure of their own. This book was a 15 out of 20 for me, and I used it for the small creator square of Book Netathon, and the creator was Head in the Books, as I know that it was one of her most highly anticipated reads of the year, and also I know that she was planning to pick it up in May. The next book that we've got is Love Beyond Body, Space and Time, which is an anthology of LGBTQ plus stories from Indigenous writers, edited by Hope Nicholson. I really, really enjoyed this anthology. All of the stories had their own unique take, and I think I pretty much liked maybe all bar one. I do remember being just really enthralled by pretty much all of them. The introductions felt a little bit on the long side. This book is only about 125 pages long, and I think there was about 15 pages of introductions, which felt excessive. However, once I got into the stories, it was one of those that I felt was really difficult to put down. So this book was a 17 out of 20, and it counted for the Et Tu Brodie square of Book Netathon. The next book that I read for Book Netathon was The Yellow Wallpaper by Charlotte Perkins Gilman. And I actually read the graphic novel version of it, which was illustrated by Sarah Barkat. This was a book that I know is important and it is quite dark, but I'm not sure if it was the prose or the artwork, but I found this book quite difficult to follow. But that could just have been where my head was when I read it, and I think it is something that I'm likely to return to in the future. So this book was a 14 out of 20 for me, and I used it for the Bookish Realm square of the bingo board. The next book that I read was With Malice by Eileen Cook. This book follows a young girl with amnesia as a result of an accident she had whilst on holiday in Italy, which led to a fatality, and now she doesn't know if it was her fault or not. I really enjoyed that it had a great, unbelievable narrator, and overall the story was quite good, and throughout you're not sure what to believe. However, there was a lot of moments that didn't quite sit right with me. It's very America-centric, and there's a repeated motif of basically saying that Italy's like some kind of underdeveloped, uncivilized country. Like, they repeatedly talk about the healthcare not being very good, and that somehow the police are useless. I don't know, it was very, very bizarre, this sort of yay America of everything. So I gave this book a 14 out of 20 and used it for the Elias square of the bingo board. The next book that I read was The Deep by River Solomon, and this is a book that, this is a story that has a interesting history, as it started out as a piece of music, and then that was developed into a track by Clipping, and then River Solomon theyself went on to create this whole story, and with each iteration it's developed and changed into something completely different. Well, not completely different, it's added another layer to the story. This book wasn't what I expected at all, but it was really, really powerful. And kind of exactly what I was wanting in that moment. This book was a 16 out of 20 for me, and I used it for the Booked and Busy square of Booknetathon. The next book that I've got is Only Revolutions by Mark Z. Danielewski. This is a book that has been sitting on my shelves for probably nearly a decade. This is the same author who wrote House of Leaves, and I would probably even argue that it's even more bizarre than House of Leaves. The way that it's written, I'm not sure if you can quite see, but you've got one narrative that way round, and then you've got the other narrative that way round, and there isn't a set way to read this book, but a lot of people, including the publishers, recommend that you read 8 pages of one of the narratives and then flip it over and read 8 pages of the other narrative, and you keep doing that for the whole 320 pages. It takes a bit of getting into, and then it does become less strange to keep reading 8 pages and flipping it over, and you also figure out what works for you. So what I ended up doing was kind of reading so it overlapped. So I essentially read 1 to 8 on one side, and then I read 1 to 16, and then 9 to 24 and 17 to 32 and kind of kept doing that. It's very, very bizarrely written. Like, ignoring the fact you have to keep flipping the book around to switch the POVs, it is written in a very bizarre style of prose, which made it somewhat difficult to follow at times. And add into that the fact that there's racist slurs, like very graphic scatological references. It was really challenging to read at times, because every time you come across something that makes you deeply uncomfortable, you know that you're going to have to read it twice, because you read it once from each POV. So this was just such a challenge to read. But then I got to the end, and it has a really beautiful ending. So it's very, very strange. The other thing I'll note, so these characters are 16, but they're 16 for the whole book, despite the fact that it spans 100 years or so. So it's a little difficult to wrap your head around. But there's like graphic sex scenes, and it felt really, really uncomfortable reading these graphic sex scenes of these characters that are supposedly 16, written by a grown man. I don't know. This was apparently I gave this a 12 out of 20, but it was so difficult to figure out what on earth I thought of this book. And I decided to tick off the square for Books and Lala with this book, because I know that she recently read House of Leaves, so I figured another book by Daniel Lewski was a good shout, I suppose. The next book that I read was The Seep by Chana Porter. This was sci-fi with a bit of a difference, I guess. I'm pretty sure that I enjoyed it. I only read it maybe a week or so ago, and yet I can only remember the very broad strokes of this story, which probably isn't a great indication of what this story was like. But I do remember enjoying it. I don't know. Unfortunately, I can't really speak much on it, because like I say, I can't remember very much of it. I did give it a 15 out of 20. And I used it for the Let Me in the Library square. The next book that I read was Kings, Queens and In-Betweens by Tanya Bethayu. It was a really, really joyous story following a young lesbian girl as she dives headfirst into drag culture and maybe also falls for a drag queen while she's at it. It had a really fun elder drag queen and lots of complex characters that had a lot going on, but also was just so, so much fun to read. I gave this book 17 out of 20, and I decided to use it for the book browsing blog square of the bingo board, because I feel like if Maddie hasn't read this book already, it's one that she would really enjoy. The next book that I read was The Raven Boys by Maggie Stiefvater. This book was just a massive disappointment for me. I know that it is very well loved, but I just did not enjoy it in the slightest. Every time that this book is blurbed, they seem to talk about the prophecy surrounding Blue that she will kill her first love or something like that. I think it's her kiss will kill her first love. When she sees a spirit on St. Mark's Eve, and the only reason for her to be able to see them is either that she kills them or they're her true love. And that's basically all that gets blurbed about this story. Unfortunately, there's a whole other element where these boys that are referred to as the Raven Boys have this kind of magical quest to seek out a long dead Welsh king, which I didn't know anything about because it never gets blurbed. But I just didn't care for that plot. I wanted to know about Blue's story, not about their quest for a long dead king. So it was just, oof. And then to add on to that, the narrator of the audiobook is laughably bad. Like, I know it's not their fault, but their accent just reminded me so much of Donald Trump. And then when they tried to do accents, there was one character that's meant to have an English accent, and it sounded like a bad impression of a German accent. No. I still want to know what happens with Blue, but I'm just not interested in what's going to happen with the Raven Boys. So I think this is a book that I would only pick up as audiobook, and I would only pick up if I had no other audiobooks available to me at that point in time and just needed another audiobook. I gave it a 12 out of 20, which probably was quite generous, and I decided to use it for the novel Serendipity square. This is probably the only square that I'm not super happy about, just because I had to really scour through their videos to try and figure out what I could use for it, as I was running out of time. The next book that I've got is A Song Below Water by Bethany C. Morrow. This follows two sisters, Tavia and Effie. Tavia is a siren, which is a magical creature that is heavily stigmatized in the community, so she must keep her identity as a siren secret. Except one day she manages to let her siren call out at completely the wrong time. And then you've got Effie, who, for all intents and purposes, you believe isn't a magical creature, but strange things seem to be happening around her. So you've got that interesting plot as well. And this was my 1 5-star of the month. I just absolutely loved it and would highly, highly recommend. So as I say, I gave it a full 20 out of 20, and I used it for the JD Ray Reads square of Booknetathon. The final book that I've got for Booknetathon was House of Earth and Blood, which is Crescent City number 1 by Sarah J. Maas. This book was just such a ride for me. I didn't feel any chemistry between the characters of Bryce and Hunt. Like, not that I minded them being together, I didn't feel any spark at all. I also thought that the pacing was very, very off. Like, there was a few things that felt really obvious, and then you had to wait literally hundreds of pages for them to be explicitly confirmed in the text. The really intense action scenes were so good. I really, really enjoyed them. But there was a lot of slow-paced not much to get to those points. And it was a book that I did find myself, like, once I got stuck into, like, wanting to pick up and needing to just get really stuck into it. I think a lot of my issues with this book comes down to the fact that it is very much the first book in a series. So there is potential for a lot to go from here. But this book had to spend a lot of time establishing things. Like, at the end of the day, essentially, this is like all of Mass's books, and it's a junk food book. I gave it 17 out of 20, and I used it for the Becca in the Books prompt of Booknetathon. And now we get on to the non-Booknetathon books that I read during the course of May. The first three are short comic graphic novel type books. They were billed as erotic horror, and I hadn't come across that genre before, so I was really curious. I'm not going to put images of the cover on the screen because they have covers that you would expect from that genre, to be honest. They're written by an author called Peter Amadi, and they are Heron Into the Belly of the Beast, numbers 1, 2, and 3. I thought they were short and sweet. I enjoyed the first one, well, as much as you can with the what they were, and I was interested to see where they would go. And then book two was like whatever. And the third one just ended very, very abruptly and in just such an unsatisfying way. So I gave the first one 11 out of 20, and the other two I gave 10 out of 20. The next book that I read was The Evolution by Tom and Giovanna Fletcher. This is book two in the Eve of Man trilogy. And overall, it wasn't a win at all. I'd really enjoyed Eve of Man, so I was interested to see where the story would go. And unfortunately, this book was just very much a book two in a trilogy. The place that the characters ended up at the end was pretty much where they started off the story. And the whole point of the book seemed to be for you to find out that, spoiler, Eve was pregnant, which was really, really obvious, basically from the point that she got together with Bram. And it was like, really? You've got a whole book just to tell me that a character's gonna get pregnant? So I gave that book a 12 out of 20. The next book that we've got is Through the Leopard's Gaze by Jambi McGrath. I had a really hard time following this book. I listened to it on audiobook, and I think it just wasn't the right format for me. Again, I don't know if it was just that I just wasn't absorbing it. But it felt like the narrative jumped around quite a lot, and I would have liked to have had a physical copy of the book so I could keep referring back to things. I gave it a 13 out of 20. It's definitely a book that I would want to give a try again in the future, just in a different format. The next book that I read was The Bright and the Pale, which was by Jessica Rupinkowski, which was a Fairy Loot book. I think it was March's Fairy Loot book, but I could be wrong. I just found it really, really dull. I just wasn't engaged with the story at all, and the romance just felt completely unnecessary. It's a book that I'm unlikely to seek out the sequel. I think a bit like Raven Boys in that I would probably grab the audiobook if I couldn't like get anything else that interested me, but I definitely wouldn't actively seek out what came next. And I gave it a 12 out of 20. The next book that I read was Lou in Lockdown by Jojo Moyes. This book is just a very short story that takes you back into the world of Me Before You, and as the title might suggest, you're seeing how the character of Lou Clark is dealing with the pandemic. I really enjoyed this book. I would have liked to have seen a little bit more of the characters, but also this book wasn't trying to be anything that it was, and it gives me hope that perhaps we will see more from Lou in the future. It does feel like every book in this series that comes out, you think that's going to be the last one, and then we get a little bit more of Lou's story. I gave it a 15 out of 20. The next book that I read was Head Full of Ghosts by Paul Tremblay. This was such a great, creepy story. It largely appears to deal with horror that's grounded in reality. Like, that is how horrible, like, humanity is. But there's a lot of moments where you start to doubt that and wonder if it is a paranormal experience, and it was just overall a horrifying book in the best way possible, and I gave it a 17 out of 20. This next book I'm not going to speak too much on because, to be quite frank, I just felt like I was too old for it. And I think that I'm not in a position to properly comment on it. And it is My Life as an Ice Cream Sandwich by Ibiza Boy. And I gave it an 8 out of 20. Not because it was bad, just because it wasn't right for me. The next book that I read was The Way of All Flesh by Ambrose Parry. This book follows a young doctor and a maid in Victorian Edinburgh as they try to track down a murderer. I really enjoyed that it was a crime story that didn't revolve around police officers and detectives. It had a different point of view, and I just felt like I could get really stuck into it. And to make it even better, the audiobook narrators for this book were absolutely exceptional. It didn't matter what accent they were doing, it always sounded convincing, and I think that really helped. And I'm looking forward to reading the next book in this series, and hopefully there'll be more after that. And for this book, I gave it a 17 out of 20. The next book that I read was Someone We Know by Shari Lapina. I just don't think this is an author for me. This is the third time that I've read a book from her, and it is the third time that I have not really enjoyed it. So I think at this point I can safely say that this author just isn't for me. Annoyingly, the murderer in this book was really, really obvious, and it employed a trope that I've seen in another book previously. Obviously I'm not gonna say, because that would spoil both the books. And also, I wrote down that the prologue ruined the book for me. However, having reread the prologue, I don't know how I got what I got. So basically, when I read the prologue, I for some reason took it as being from a female perspective. So every time in the book that a male culprit was presented, I'm going, no, because you know it's not a man. But then I've just reread it and I have no idea where I got that from. But because I read it as being a woman, like, I just couldn't get behind any of the culprits. they just didn't do it for me, this book, unfortunately. And I think I'm just going to have to say I'm not really interested in reading from this author again. And I gave it a 12 out of 20. The final book that I've got is People in Trouble by Sarah Shulman. This book was a Queer Book Box pick. And it was difficult. Like, I think it probably needs a deeper reading. Like, I just read for fun. I don't read to analyse, you know, beyond telling you my thoughts. It follows a married couple and the wife's mistress in 1980s New York City around the AIDS crisis. And it's kind of how all their lives are touched. But you're following these three point of views, and like neither of the people of the married couple are particularly likeable. The husband, he's called Peter, is very narcissistic, homophobic, and just generally quite gross. And then the wife, Kate, she is just so like bizarrely hating on her girlfriend like all the time. And she also has a lot of internalized homophobia. And I wanted more from this book, and it just didn't give me more. I think I did enjoy the perspective of Molly, who's Kate's girlfriend, but she's also used to kind of bring in all the AIDS crisis stuff, because a lot of her friends obviously are dying around her. But because of that, a lot of different people are mentioned, and it's quite difficult to follow who all these people are and how they relate to Molly or Kate or Peter. So it just wasn't particularly enjoyable. There were some things that I'm not sure if it's meant to be subtext or you're meant to just read into it what you want, but just weren't there as well. I gave it 12 out of 20. So in total, in the month of May, I read 27 books, which was 4,077 pages and 98 hours and 27 minutes of audiobooks, which works out as an equivalent of 7,811 pages. I gave one book a 5-star. Sorry, all of these ratings are like rounded down to the nearest 4-star. So I gave one book 5 stars, 11 books 4 stars, 3 books, 11 star, no, 11 books, 3 stars, 4 books, 2 stars. And my favourite book of the month was A Song Below Water by Bethany C. Morrow. So if you like this picture, give me a like. And please comment below what books you read in May and what was your favourite. And until next time, bye!